Hi, my name is CORI Yarbrough, and I'm the Executive Director of the Hispanic Black Gay Coalition. I'm excited to be here for another installment of our video series speaking with Boston mayor candidates for this year's election. Today, I have the opportunity to sit down with Councillor John Connolly. Councillor John Connolly is a Boston native and former school teacher who has been on the Boston City Council since 2007. He is also the chair of the Education Committee for the Boston City Council. Today, I am sitting down with him to talk about crime, immigration, race relations, and green jobs for LGBT communities of color.
Councilor Connolly, thank you for being here today.
Thanks, CORI.
Really appreciate it. So I want to go ahead and dive into some questions. So let's start by you sharing a little bit more about why you decided to step from city councilor at large to the race for mayor.
I wanted to make sure that we were focused on Boston's future, because I think while we are a thriving city in many respects, we still have a lot of work to do, and we need to recognize that we've got to make some changes and adapt in order to remain competitive as a city, maintain a high quality of life, but also solve problems in ways that other cities can't. You know, we have tremendous resources in this city, start with our hospitals, our laboratories, colleges, universities, and so on. But at the same time, we've got a real equity gap in this city, whether it's housing, economic opportunity, safety, or education. There's a lot of work that we have to do, and I wanted to make sure that we were talking about how we would do this for Boston's future.
Okay, great. And when you talk about all those issues, that brings to mind diversity and the fact that on your website, one of the main platforms of your campaign is embracing diversity. So tell me a little bit, as city councilor at large, you've already had that task of being able to serve the entire city. So how have you done that as city councilor, and how will you especially do that for communities of color as mayor?
Right. Well, I think it starts as a value, and it's something that people just have to read in the candidates, is do you hold diversity as a central value in your life? And for me, I absolutely do. I think that we are a city strengthened by our diversity, strengthened by our different walks of life, our different languages, the different places we come from. And this makes us a better city.
Okay.
And so for me, that means a real effort to bring what I think will be the most diverse cabinet in the history of the city of Boston if I'm elected mayor, but a commitment to make sure that we're empowering all communities around Boston, whether that's a multilingual call service center, a focus on adult education, or in this case, continuing Mayor Menino's great work to make this an LGBT friendly city, inclusive city, and what I would say is one of the leading LGBT friendly cities in the country. We want to continue that great work of Mayor Menino and make sure that we continue to have a culture in city government, but throughout the whole city, every fiber of it, that is inclusive and recognizes that we're strengthened by our diversity.
Okay, great. So I noticed one of the things on your website when you're talking about diversity or being more inclusive of the LGBT community is the fight to have the gay games hosted in Boston. It seems like something you're really passionate about.
Yeah.
So tell me of all the issues out there for the LGBT community, why you prioritize this really high.
Right, so I'm really proud to have sponsored a resolution in support of bringing the gay games to Boston that I did as a city councilor, in addition to multiple times sponsoring legislation for transgendered equity. And also before my time on the city council, I managed a campaign for equal marriage rights before the Goodridge decision, for a candidate for state representative. I was a pro bono legal counsel to the Pride Lights Foundation, which ultimately was merged in with the AIDS Action Committee. And so I have a long history of advocacy for equality and for the LGBT community in Boston. But one reason why, in answer to your question, I really want to bring the gay games to Boston is I want to have an agenda that's proactive and celebrates the strength of our LGBT community in Boston. So while I think it's really important to work on the disparities, really important to work on inclusivity, and really important to reach out to people who are being alienated and isolated in this city, I think the gay games can be a worldwide symbol of Boston's inclusiveness and our recognition of the great strength the LGBT community brings to all of Boston. And so I want to go out, put money behind that bid, go out and get it, and bring the gay games here to Boston, and just really make that statement globally about our commitment to an inclusive Boston.
Okay, sounds good, sounds good. And as you talk to some of about some of the disparities, I do want to get into to those, because I think for a lot of voters, that is what is on their minds. So I want to start by talking about hate crimes against the LGBT community. And in 2001, the FBI actually ranked Boston number two in regards to sexually orientation motivated hate crimes. In the nation. So, one, what is your response to that? And then, B, as mayor, how will you help to reduce that?
Yep. So, I think part of this starts with law enforcement itself, where we want to make sure that we are training and developing our police officers to respond appropriately and understand appropriate response to any type of hate crime. So that's one end of it. But the second piece is, what are we doing to educate people, starting from the earliest ages, about the importance of diversity, inclusivity, and really trying to work from a preventative stage to make sure that we that no one in this city should ever fear for their safety because of who they are. And so I think we have to be, you know, fully committed every day to making sure that we're working on that. I think education and prevention is a big piece of it, but I also support, you know, hate crimes legislation very strongly, and want to make sure that our law enforcement has strong ties to all communities, but the LGBT community for sure, in terms of how we respond to any such incidents in Boston. And that includes developing and recruiting more officers who are members of the LGBT community, and having that standalone presence in the police department that's going to be there for response to any such incidents. But obviously the prevention and education side is where we really want to get to, just to make sure it never happens.
Yeah. So when you mentioned more hate crimes legislation, a lot of people in our community, particularly myself, sometimes can get into this dilemma where you do on one end want more hate crime legislation because you want people held accountable for their actions, but you do recognize that mass incarceration is a real thing, and something that disproportionately impacts people of color. So how, as you push for more hate crime legislation, will you ensure that the mass incarceration of people of color don't increase?
Yep, so this is a huge concern for me. It's why the really centerpiece of my campaign revolves around transforming the Boston Public Schools. And I'm a former teacher, and I'm a Boston Public School parent, and I chair the City Council's Education Committee. And we need to transform our Boston Public Schools as the foundation for our future. But one of the pieces that we're trying to accomplish here is to end the school-to-prison pipeline. And that is a big driver on the inequity in this city. And so we want to have world-class urban public schools. We want to have a public school system that sets a standard nationally in order to close that achievement gap and that school-to-prison pipeline. And that will go a long way towards safer neighborhoods and toward a safe and healthy neighborhood agenda that I would also want to put into place as mayor. And I think in many of those cases, when I talk about a safe and healthy neighborhood agenda, it's a comprehensive effort aimed, again, on the prevention, intervention, and opportunity side, so that we're trying to reach that 12-year-old who goes into that school-to-prison pipeline long before he or she ever turns 12. And that's about mentoring. It's about youth development. It's about not just summer jobs, but year-round jobs for young people. And it's about creating pathways of opportunity that show a young person that they have a way they can go that's positive, where they can make a difference and where they can build a great life for themselves. But we've got to create those pathways. And I think that ultimately is the key to creating safe and healthy neighborhoods and ending the mass incarceration, which is the end product or the byproduct of the school to prison pipeline.
So tell me more about creating those pathways and creating those resources. Is there a specific plan or way that you intend to do that? And something that's, I guess, at the top of my head is recently Councilor Yancey's vote to take out a loan for a new high school was rejected by the city council, but you voted in favor of it. So is that one thing that you would continue to push as mayor, the creation of a new high school, or how will we get the resources to our communities?
Yep. So when I talk about a safe and healthy neighborhood agenda, I could talk about it for days on end in terms of the programming and the approaches that make a difference, because it's everything. It's all connected. From a public health strategy to a housing strategy to an environmental health strategy, these things all connect to create safe and healthy neighborhoods and pathways of opportunity. And I just want to be clear on that, because you're talking about everything from how we deal with addiction and how we deal with mental health, how we deal with trauma response, to some of the unfortunate byproducts of that, domestic violence, homelessness. So we're talking about a whole set of programs there. But when it comes to our schools, yeah, I look at Mattapan High School and I say, yes, that should be part of the solution of safe and healthy neighborhoods. And the part of the story that's not told there, and where I commend Councilor Yancey for his leadership, is that we have roughly 30 high schools in Boston. A little over half of them are not accredited. Mm-hmm. Part of the reason they can't seek accreditation is they have subpar facilities. Now, of the group that are accredited, almost half of them are on warning to lose their accreditation, in large part because of facilities. And so we have a crumbling school infrastructure and a declining high school population. And the majority of the elected officials in the city fail to see that part of solving this problem is building better facilities for our young people that will connect them to jobs and opportunities in today's economy. And we want to connect our schools to those opportunities. We've got to build better facilities. Clearly, the other part of it is great programming.
Yeah.
And you've got to combine great programming with great facilities. But that's why I support Mattapan High School, which I would like to see be an environmental sciences academy focused on preparing young people to take jobs in the environmental sciences and to connect with our growing green technology and clean energy sector here in Boston.
Great.
And that's how you create pathways of opportunity in part.
And is that something that you would be looking to directly push as mayor?
Or, yes,
okay,
absolutely.
So that's something that's high on your list?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Great, great, good to hear. Another aspect of education is on your website, you mentioned providing full social and emotional support to students. And one way that HBGC does that is through establishing Gay Straight Alliance. We received national attention this year for launching a successful GSA at the Burke High School, which
right.
is a 97% Black and Latino school.
Yep.
So tell me more about if you support GSAs, or what specific support for LGBT students do you think we need in schools?
Sure, I absolutely support GSAs, and they've been proven to reduce bullying in schools and to change the environment in schools so that all students can go to school feeling safe and having an opportunity to learn. So I think they are vitally important to raising awareness, building bridges, and connecting our young people in our schools. And we know that it's our LGBT youth that are disproportionately impacted by bullying and have higher suicide rates. Black and Latino students who are gay will feel a greater isolation and alienation. And so to have GSAs in schools and to have them in a school like the Burke, I think makes a great difference. And certainly as someone who will pride myself on being an education mayor, I want to see that as a key component in our schools.
Great.
And I would also mention, I think our partnerships with our community-based organizations, such as your organization, are vital to how we get the job done. We don't want the city government to put this all on one back to try and get this done. It's about the city government shining the light on problems, pointing to the places we have to focus on, but then utilizing the power of our community-based organizations and all the talent there to get the job done.
Great, great. Let's shift gears a bit and talk about health disparities, particularly around HIV/AIDS. So in Massachusetts, Black people make up 6% of the population, but are 29% of those living with HIV. And similarly, the Latino population is 8% of the state population, making up 25% of those living with HIV. So whereas Massachusetts has been commended for reducing the overall new infections of HIV, it's still heavily affecting communities of color. So what is your plan for particularly dealing with the epidemic in those communities?
Yeah, we have a serious, serious health disparity issue within the issue itself here as we see the populations that are most impacted here. So I look at some of AIDS Action Committee's work here, including, you know, opening a pharmacy within one of their facilities as a way to try and have better full service outreach to folks, particularly underserved folks in the city. I think that we've got to tap into organizations like yours. We've got to tap in to Fenway Health Center, which does groundbreaking work that's recognized on a national basis. But we want to, again, empower these institutions in Boston and these organizations in Boston to help really focus on that multi-service approach. And part of that, though, is the information piece and the outreach piece to people living with HIV. And I want to, through the Public Health Commission and through every information resource we have in the city, make sure that we're empowering our community-based organizations and our health centers to do great work on this, because we should be proud of the record we have, but we still have a long way to go.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So as we speak right now, the world is kind of dealing and responding to the verdict in the George Zimmerman case. Yeah. And, you know, just last week there was a huge protest in Dudley Square. So I'm curious on your thoughts on the verdict and if anything, what you've learned about the Boston community from how we've reacted here.
Yeah, I think it's great that we've had a peaceful response, but mm-hmm. I think the sad part for all of us beyond just the Boston community is the tragedy that's unfolded here. I certainly don't feel that justice has been done. I think it still points to major faults in our justice system mm-hmm. that back up the inequity that still exists, and certainly the fact that race is still very much an issue in our society. For all the progress we may have made, we still have tremendous disparities and tremendous issues around race in our society. And when our justice system reflects those inequities, we have to take a careful look and recognize that we need to make a lot of changes. So ultimately, as a parent, mm-hmm. My heart just breaks for Trayvon Martin's family and what they're going through on that personal level. And my heart breaks for our society as a whole. Because we see the inequity through this ruling, and we see the problems in our justice system.
Mm-hmm. So how would you describe race relations in Boston?
I would say that they are vastly improved as someone okay. who grew up here, and I think yeah. that's important to note, because I grew up in a time, and I'm deeply shaped and influenced by a time when this city was so polarized that the social fabric of it was being ripped apart during a very just battle to bring equity to our school system. Mm-hmm. So as a former teacher, someone who's passionate about education, but someone who also grew up in Boston in the 1970s and 1980s, I've seen this city at a very low point on race relations, and I've seen the great divide in this city. It's mm-hmm. really important to me to try and raise my children in a different city than the Boston I grew up in. Mm-hmm. I want to see it where there's opportunity for all, and where we're all truly working together. So I'd say we've made great progress, but we still have a long way to go, mm-hmm. Because we can see in the employment rate, we can see when we look at crime statistics, we can see in housing, and we can see in our school system that the role and existence of institutional and systemic racism is still very much alive in this country, and mm-hmm. certainly in Boston. And we can see the disparities and the divide, not just along class lines, but very clearly along race lines as well. And so we've got a lot of work to do. We've made great progress, but we have a lot of work to do.
Okay. And one of your solutions, especially when it comes to economics and jobs, is green jobs and okay. Your disenvironmental platform. And tell me a little bit about where people of color fit into your environmental platform. Are green jobs going to be available to communities of color? And also keeping in mind that many people in communities of color are LGBT, so they may face discrimination for being LGBT or being a person of color. So how will you ensure that our communities, all of our communities, can access those green jobs?
Right. I talk yeah. about it on two levels. In terms of green jobs specifically, mm-hmm. I'm proud to have played a role in helping to launch the Renew Boston effort to perform energy audits and weatherization mm-hmm. On residential homes throughout Boston. Yeah. And one of the models that we used for this was to leverage funds over to community-based organizations like ACE and have them do job training for people who would then take jobs with the companies performing the audits and the weatherization piece. And it wasn't an easy ride there. There were a lot of bumps along the way. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, I think we created a model that okay. empowered people in this city, and in particular, people from communities of color, to access those jobs and take a role in the green economy here in Boston. I want to deepen that. Mm-hmm. I want to use that model where we use community-based organizations for workforce training and then create pipelines to jobs, particularly in the green economy and clean energy sector. But I also want to tap into our vocational education in our public schools and create pathways to jobs through our schools for our young people. And certainly, I think the focus has got to be on creating these jobs and pathways for our most underserved communities in Boston, which would most definitely be targeted at opening up economic opportunity for people of color, for members of the LGBT community as well. Now, there's another piece to this, which is how do we retain businesses in Boston? How do we make sure the next Facebook doesn't leave Boston? Mm-hmm. How do we make sure all those technology companies stay here, whether it's green tech or another area of the economy? And I think that comes down to rent and taxes when I talk to CEOs. And I'm willing as mayor to work on finding the rents that will keep a business here or extending the tax incentives to businesses to keep them here. Mm-hmm. What I want in return is a commitment to partner with community-based organizations on workforce training. And that in that partnership, make real commitments to hire people who come through those programs and hire them to take jobs in these companies so that we have great companies here. But not just that, that we've got economic opportunity from those companies for everyone. Mm-hmm. And certainly partnering with organizations focused on LGBT rights and focused on job training and equity for our communities of color is vitally important. Mm-hmm. And I think about organizations like yours, but I also think about organizations like Strive in Dorchester, right outside of Cobman Square. And we ought to be using our relationships with businesses here to formalize mm-hmm. these understandings and create real pipelines for jobs.
Great, great. Another population that has a difficult time getting jobs is the formerly incarcerated population. And it is a population that HBGC has dedicated a lot of time to this year. Earlier this year, we had a summit for formerly incarcerated LGBT people. And from that conference came a list of demands for policymakers. And I'm just curious to get your opinion on some of these, if I could just read maybe four or five of these off. LGBT inclusive healthcare in jails and prisons, decriminalization of sex work, eliminating CORIs, insecure community, the ICE incentive, and let's say full funding for HIV programs.
Okay.
So I'm just curious.
You
want to
go
one by one?
You want me to speak to it generally?
Well, I would be curious. Did anything stand out as something you absolutely do not support or would not support as mayor?
So was legalized prostitution one of those?
Yes, decriminalization of sex work. Yes.
Yeah, I would not support that. But,
okay.
I would support, I certainly believe in immigration reform and don't think that the Secure Communities Act has worked for our cities and don't want Boston to participate in that.
Okay.
I definitely believe I'm a strong supporter and have a voting record for CORI reform.
Mm-hmm.
And
how would you like to see CORI reform?
Well, I think at this point we have many of the laws on the books that we want to have. There's probably a few pieces where we need to loosen it some mm-hmm. more and make sure, particularly when I think about people who have ended up in court but with no ultimate findings, and yet that will follow them for the rest of their lives, and those pieces should not be out there.
Mm-hmm.
Keeping somebody from getting access to a job. But there's, I think, a bigger piece at this point, which is to make sure that employers are following the law, because I think we know in many cases they very quietly find ways to sift out applicants and not give anybody a chance who's in reentry. And so I think from a city standpoint, we've got to be vigilant about making sure employers are honoring that. And then as a city, I think we've got to do a better job enforcing ordinances that we have on the books that say, if you're going to do any work with the city, if you're going to get any contracts from the city, you're going to respect the CORI laws. And I'd rather kind of move that to the next step and actually look at hiring as a criteria to win those contracts. I think that is that's important. Let's see real results, not just a tacit agreement to hire offenders, but actual numbers that show you've done it. I think that's the part. We've got to move to the point where we're focused on enforcement, awareness about employers doing the job and then actually insisting on results to work with the city.
Okay. Great, great. So I want to end on what I call my lightning round. And so these four questions are all questions I'm ending our interviews with and asking every single candidate. And it's basically a fill in the blank or finish the sentence. So in about four or five words, try to complete the following for me, okay? The first is, a more equal and just Boston requires?
A city government and city leadership that reflects all of Boston.
Okay, thanks. A personal hero of mine is?
Well, that's a tough one. I'm going to say Adam Gray, who is a Boston teacher, a former Boston teacher who did amazing work and then lost his job as a Boston teacher.
Mm, okay. As a leader, I am looking to improve in the area of?
I would say that it's always listening. And I pride myself on being a good listener, but elected officials, we can never spend too much time listening.
Okay, great. And then last is, to the Black and Latino LGBT community, I pledge?
To carry on Mayor Menino's legacy and to work every day for a Boston that is just and celebrates equity and equality for all residents.
Do you want to say anything about where they can find your campaign or get LinkedIn?
It's ConnollyForBoston.com.
Okay.
I'm the Connolly with two N's and two L's.
Exactly. Okay. Don't get confused. All right. Thank you so much for your
time.
A lot.